I was making my way down the path through the park. I typically did this when the days were nice and the skies were clear. My husband didn't always join me on these outings, but today he decided to. He was walking only a few steps ahead of me, however, and seeing all the other couples in the park holding hands made me want to do the same. But just as I reached out to grab his hand, he stopped, pointed, and told me to look. I did so and was met with the most interesting sight of a young girl, looking no more than 15 or 16 years of age, standing under the familiar oak tree. She was wearing a typical mime dress with her hair done in long braided pigtails. Her painted face looked like a porcelain doll. In the true mime fashion, her actions were kneeling and twisting with her gloved hands moving up and down to portray some sort of container opening. Her face held no emotion as she did this, which only served to intrigue us both, and we soon found ourselves wandering over to her. We watched in awe as she bent low to act as if she was pulling things from a crate or box that she had just opened. After only a minute, she stopped and looked up at us. A smile formed on her face, and she stood up, looking like she was now holding something about a foot in diameter. Curling her arms around it, she held the invisible thing close to her, like a mother would a child. She rocked it, kissed it, stroked it, even acted like she was changing it and dressing it. All the while, her face held the calming grin. It would have made me sigh in sweet admiration, as it did the other onlookers, if it weren't for the fact that she had originally portrayed it as being pulled from a container filled with other objects. That one session disturbed me a bit, but still I stayed, and still I watched. The mime girl took the bundle and began putting it to bed. She covered it up and patted its head before turning her attention back to the invisible container. Again she knelt over it, and again she began acting like she was pulling things out of it, this time in a more comedic fashion, making faces and pretending to get tangled or hit in the face with whatever object she would pull out. The crowd laughed and giggled as they witnessed the spectacle. Such innocence surrounded this girl in her miming routine that I wondered why she would be miming in the first place. Most mimes were grown adults that had very crappy jobs or no jobs and used miming as a way of making an extra buck. Young and pretty girls like her were typically in school at this time, and almost none of them never took up miming as a profession. Add to that the fact that this girl had a look of flawlessness in her appearance that suggested any such narcotics like drugs or alcohol were never imbibed. So why was she out here then? This question puzzled me a great deal and almost made me feel sorry for her. What kind of life had she been living that would drive her to performing on the streets for meager bits of change? I decided I was going to talk to her after she was finished and get to the bottom of this. If she needed help, I would be glad to assist her. The girl stood up once more, acting like she was holding something heavy. She dragged whatever it was out of the container and over to where she had pretended to lay the infant. When she stopped, she stood again and wiped her brow, turning her expression into an annoyed one. Then, stomping her foot in frustration, she began to act like she was fiddling with some part of the big, heavy thing. It looked to me as if she was trying to open whatever it was. Now I was even more puzzled than before. What kind of mime routine was this? None of it was making any sense. I decided that even though her execution wasn't too awfully bad, her actual story she was portraying was amateur at best. I suspected she hadn't been performing that long. Mimes, while doing humorous and interesting moves, still tend to be clearer on what it is they're doing. This girl was nowhere near clear as to what she was attempting to accomplish. Suddenly, she jumped up and down like she was cheering. I guessed that the large thing had finally come open. She pretended to hold something in her hands then, something flat and angular. A lid, perhaps? Now I was really confused. She knelt down again and moved her arm in a turning type motion, like you would if you were turning a lever of some sort. Then she nodded profoundly and began to act as if she was just adjusting things. Strange as it may seem, her adjustments of the invisible thing were leading me down a familiar road of thought. It began to nag at me relentlessly as her hands moved over and over, revealing that she was messing around with some sort of spout. What type of heavy thing has a turning lever on one side, a spout on the other, and an opening at the top. It may seem like such a little thing that most would simply glance over it, but for some reason, I just couldn't. The mime girl stood up once more and carefully picked up the infant from the place she had pretended to lay it. Her face turned to catch me right in the eyes as she knelt down, a grin of the darkest intent across her cheeks. I stared at her yellow orbs, not blinking as she stared back. It was the first time I had even really noticed the color of her eyes. Such an unnatural yellow gave her the look of some spawn out of hell. Carefully, she lifted the invisible babe over the heavy thing. With a sudden burst of fear and remorse, I knew what she was doing. The heavy thing. It was a meat grinder. I gasped in horror as she pretended to stuff the infant down into it and turn the lever. A sudden rush of sickening cracks and cries rang out through the air. It's as if the hellish deed was happening right in front of me, even though nothing could be seen. I covered my ears as tears formed in my eyes. The sounds were more than I could handle. I wanted to turn and run, but my feet wouldn't let me. It's as if they were stuck fast. I released a scream, looking to her with pleading eyes, but she didn't care. Madness seemed to consume her as she began to turn the lever faster, the sound growing more sickening as the screams faded away to nothing but a grinding whir of crushing blades. Then she stopped, and the sound halted. I lowered my hands and heard only the sounds of the birds in the park once more. The mime girl stood slowly and walked back to the tree, picking up a decorative wooden box painted white. It was about the size of a shoebox, with metal coverings on each of the corners. Floral design could be carved along the lip of the sides, and a generic smiley face could be seen printed in black on the lid. She smiled sweetly and opened it, holding out the box to us. I gulped as I looked inside. I only saw a few pennies. Was she really expecting us to give her money after what we had just witnessed? I was in shock and could only stand with my mouth agape. Suddenly, my husband stepped forward in a threatening manner. In my astonishment, I hadn't noticed that I was able to move again. And when he did, I stumbled slightly. I looked at him, and he was fuming. He began to shout, screaming at her, in demand of what the hell kind of game she thought she was playing and what kind of sicko she was. The mime girl's smile faded, and her gaze narrowed on him. Still, he screamed. The other onlookers either took a step forward as if to agree with my husband or turned and hurried away from the scene. I wanted to be one of them, but I couldn't leave my husband like this. I stepped up and grabbed his arm in an attempt to urge him to come with me, but he only shrugged me off, yelling at her to speak to him. He demanded that she answer his questions and grabbed her sharply by the arm. The girl snarled at him like an animal, then opened her mouth in a demonic growl. I gasped and my husband let go of her quickly. Inside her mouth, where her tongue should have been, was a gnarled stump, much like something had ripped it clean out of her mouth. All we did was stare at her, unable to fathom the words to say. Again, she held out the box, this time in a much more demanding way. My husband pushed it away, claiming she wasn't getting a cent from him. I, on the other hand, began to feel remorse once more. This girl must have been, or was being, severely abused. That could explain the missing tongue and absence from school. I also began to suspect that the sounds were from a radio hidden on her person somewhere, and theorized that her accumulation of the sounds was in itself a mystery I was too scared to solve, and told myself they were from the internet. Digging out my wallet, I pulled out the only $2 I had and dropped it into the box. My husband looked at me angrily but said nothing. I knew there was going to be a heated argument when we got home. The girl, however, smiled warmly and nodded a thank you to me before closing the lid and bounding away. This confused me a little until I looked around us and noticed that we were the only ones still standing there. On the way home, we argued about the situation. He kept stating that I shouldn't have given anything to that sick display, and I kept up with my own rebuttal about my abuse theory. He wasn't buying it for the most part, but eventually settled down on the matter, that I could in fact have a point. I kept on with the feeling of guilt that was plaguing me about simply letting the girl go off, but my husband insisted that it was probably for the best, considering we didn't know what sort of violence the girl would scourge upon our own household. I tried to argue with the fact that her missing tongue was a sign of something quite severe, but he still refused to go back and somehow convinced me that calling the police when we got home and reporting the incident would be far better than getting into a heated fight with a family we didn't know about a girl we knew nothing about. The whole thing made me shiver. The thought of someone abusing their child like that was enough to make me sick. And even though my well-meaning husband began prattling on about me, overlooking the fact that this girl might have just had an accident involving her tongue or was just going through a rebellious streak, didn't seem to heed my lingering worry. All I wanted to do right now was get home and hug my own children. As we rounded the corner, our house came into view. Flashes of red and blue lights littered the driveway, and a slew of officers trampled through the yard like a bunch of worrisome deer. Without missing a beat, we ran up the way to where our 16-year-old daughter was kneeling by the ambulance and sobbing relentlessly into her hands. I immediately took her into my arms, and she wrapped hers around me in a tight and fearful embrace. "I don't know what happened," she proceeded to scream through the sobs, and she buried her face in me. I pet her hair softly, trying to keep my cool, as my husband hurriedly spoke with a nearby officer. "I couldn't do anything," she sobbed again. "I just don't know what happened. One minute, he was sleeping in the crib, and the next..." She trailed off, choking a bit on her tears. "What happened next?" I asked frantically, my own tears forming behind my eyes. "Where is your brother?" My heart hung in my chest, as I expected the worst. "He was screaming," she cried out. "He was screaming so loudly, and the machine! I could hear the machine!" She held up her hands to me. It was then that I noticed that they had been bandaged up tightly. "I was banging on the door, Mom," she sobbed. "I was banging on the door as hard as I could, but it wouldn't open. Oh God, it wouldn't open!" "Carly," I said somewhat harshly, shaking her a bit. She was being hysterical, and I, in my own worry and need, wanted to hear what had happened to my baby. Tears poured from my eyes now as I turned her face back to me. "What happened to your brother?"
"I don't know," she shouted up at me. "When I broke down the door, there was just a pile of ground flesh and bone."